tube. Today, the 2nd of May 2022. Exceptional program. Headlines. Abiy's regime is a modern version of the Ethiopian Empire State, the 25th of April 2022 by Asafa Jalata, Ethiopia Insight. Ethiopia's multinational federalism ruins Isaias's assimilationist scheme, the 19th of April 2022 by Hagos Kabrimlak.
Abiy's botched centralization fuels Ethiopia's feuding centrifugal forces.
The Politics and Problems of Prosperity Party Gospel, the 4th of April 2021 by Mulabran Balrain.
Ethiopian Prime Minister turned down offer from EAC country to send fighters to help against rebels, source claims, Sudan's Post, May 1, 2022. Under international pressure, the federal government promised a truce in Tigray but is now losing ground to the Oromo insurgency. An Oromo rebellion constrains Abiy, the 28th of April 2022, Sudan's Post, May 1, 2022. Ethiopia's Tigray government claim withdrawal from afar, but Abiy's government denies.
Abiy's regime is a modern version of the Ethiopian Empire State, the 25th of April 2022 by Asafa Jalata, Ethiopia Insight. Political marginalization, cultural repression, economic exploitation, and state violence in Oromia reflect a continuation of Ethiopia's imperial history. After becoming prime minister in 2018, Abiy Ahmed positioned himself as a man of peace and democracy who would transition Ethiopia from its troubled past. This initially won him many supporters, both domestically and internationally. He was also applauded for signing a peace deal with Eritrean President Isaias Afwerki, granting amnesty to political prisoners, and reducing press censorship in Ethiopia. As a result, he was awarded the Nobel Peace Prize in 2019. But within a short time, Abiy reversed most of the reforms he had overseen. He started to show a second face, one of cruelty, manifested in state terrorism and massive human rights violations. While much attention was given to his administration and allies' atrocities in Tigray, state terrorism in Oromia is also rampant. As with violence against many long marginalized communities in Ethiopia, Abiy's brutal repression in Oromia and against Oromos is not new. The perception among Oromo nationalists is that Abiy, like many of his predecessors, is running a neo-Neftegna administration that exalts the glories of Ethiopia's imperial history and seeks to continue its oppressive, brutal, and exploitative practices. Imperial history. Defining what a neo-Neftegna administration is requires an understanding of the historical Neftegna Guba system. Menelik II and his collaborators created the Neftegna Guba system as a form of settler colonialism in the last decades of the 19th century by settling Amharas, and other ethnic groups, mainly Highlander Orthodox Christians, in Oromia and the broader Ethiopian south. Conquering the central and southern nations and incorporating them into the Ethiopian Empire did not occur voluntarily or peacefully. Many resisted and fought against their colonizers, and this resulted in countless victims being massacred and enslaved. The colonizing army looted cattle and grain, and committed horrifying acts of mutilation, such as cutting the breasts of women and hands of men. The army then established a system of control over the rest of the population by dispossessing them of their land, exploiting their labor, and taking their agricultural products. At times, when Gubbers failed to provide what was required, they were sold as slaves. Why did Ethiopia's prime minister blame African Americans for their victimization? By Asafa Jalata. The settlers or neftegna, meaning musketeers, including soldiers, clergymen, and administrators, exploited the Gubbers. Gubbers were treated as serfs and, in some instances, as slaves. They provided labor, tribute, and tax revenue to their new lords. This system claimed absolute right over approximately three-quarters of the Oromo lands and provided portions of it to its officials and soldiers as a salary. Some land was granted to the Oromo collaborators who became the agents of the neftegna system by engaging in the exploitation and oppression of the Oromo people. While the neftegna system has a pronounced cultural aspect, Amhara thefted from Tigray culture, Amharic language, Orthodox Christianity tradition, and so on, it is also class-based. Many Oromos and others from marginalized communities have been part of the system since imperial times, mainly to advance and protect their economic and class interests. One notable Oromo collaborator, Gabana Desi, played a significant role in helping Menelik II in his efforts to expand his kingdom and subjugate peoples in what is today central and southern Ethiopia. Many Oromo nationalists now use the term Gabana or Neo-Gabana to describe those who collaborate with the Ethiopian state and stand against the interest of the Oromo masses. Oromo nationalism in the era of prosperity party by Negesse Dube. Emperor Haile Selassie's government expanded and consolidated the Neftegna Gubber system before changes occurred in the Ethiopian Empire state during subsequent administrations that came to power in 1974, 1991, and 2018. Although the 1974 revolution nationalized land and changed the status of the Gubber in the central and southern regions, the fundamental nature of the state was not changed. In fact, the new militarized socialist state intensified the brutalization of marginalized groups, including Oromos. The same is true about the change of government in 1991. Despite the TPLF-dominated EPRDF adopting multinational federalism, it largely existed only on paper. The EPRDF was never really committed to the self-determination rights that it gave lip service to. Tigrayan elites and their collaborators from other ethnic groups were dominant and, in line with the neo-Neftegna predecessors, exploited marginalized groups. Rewriting history, critics characterize the current regime as neo-Neftegna, because it tries to modernize the Ethiopian state by glorifying imperial leaders and the history of the empire while denigrating the history of marginalized communities. Habesha elites under successive regimes have denied the colonization of the Oromo and presented them as invaders of Ethiopia, referring to the so-called Oromo migrations of the 16th and 17th centuries. But, as demonstrated by Muhammad Hassan and Mikuria Bulcha, the way Oromos are portrayed as invader expansionists is false. For instance, according to these two scholars, the Talama Oromo lived around the Blue Nile long before Christian highlanders moved to these areas in the 13th century. Revealing Barara, the long-lost African medieval city by Samuel C. Walker, the neo-Neftegna system defenders use portrayals of Oromos as expansionist invaders to justify the brutal expansion of the Ethiopian state. In his various historically void speeches, Abiy lectures the long marginalized peoples of Ethiopia to forget how the Ethiopian Empire State brutalized the Oromo, Sidama, Somali, Kimant, Agu, Walata, Gambela, Berta, Gumas, and others. When Abiy articulates the greatness of Ethiopia and its leaders, what comes to mind for many members of these groups is brutality, state terrorism, and human rights violations. Despite Abiy and the Ethiopianist camp that supports him trying to discredit the historical narrative of these victimized groups and legitimize the crimes of successive Ethiopian governments, the people will never forget their real history. Cultural destruction. Abiy's Neo-Neftenga administration has also started ideological warfare on Oromoma, Oromo history, culture, identity, and nationalism by glorifying Amhara nationalism disguised as Ethiopianism. As the new administration tries to revive the assimilationist nation-building project, one aspect of the strategy involves the systematic attack of Oromo political and cultural institutions. Despite Abiy's administration giving lip service to the importance of Gadar, Sikhi leaders, it is oppressing Gadar leaders who are the custodians of Oromo culture, institutions, and democracy. For instance, on 1 December 2021, federal and Oromia government forces attacked a Gadar religious ceremony in Karayu, East Shewa Zone. They beat and abducted the Abba Gadar, the traditional head of religious, social, legal, and economic affairs, other community leaders, and innocent young men. The bodies of 14 people, including the Abba Gadar, were found the next day, while 25 others were unaccounted for and are believed to be dead. The administration has also intimidated and discouraged the primary Oromo civic institution known as the Maha Talama Self-Help Association (MTA) from functioning in Addis Abeba, Finfini, and beyond. In August 2020, Diribi Demuse Boku, the president of the association, was beaten by government forces at his home in Barayu. Like its predecessors, this administration has effective control over the country's political economy and uses the military, police, and other security forces to suppress dissent. Ethiopian prisons are now mainly filled with Afaan Oromo and Tigrinya speakers, and the offices of many private media, such as the Oromia Media Network (OMN), are closed. Almost all top leaders of the OLF are in prison today, and its chairman, Dawood Ibsa, was released from house arrest only recently, while the OFC's leaders were in jail until a few months ago. This is part of a long history of targeting any community and its leaders that refuse to submit to the center. Sadly, rather than criticizing the Prime Minister's centralizing ambitions that caused the current crisis, most Amhara elites, Amhara media, and state media often blame Oromos and Tigrayans for Ethiopia's ills. Economic exploitation. Abiy's government has continued the policy of land dispossession from farmers and pastoralists in Oromia and the other colonized regions. In an impoverished country like Ethiopia, any wealthy government official has become rich by commodifying public resources, such as land, particularly in Oromia and other areas in the fertile south. This has enabled Abiy to buy those elites who are ready to sell themselves to accumulate wealth and enjoy a luxurious lifestyle at the cost of impoverished people. Abiy understands this neo-patrimonial system and uses it effectively to ensure loyalty. There is, for instance, a high degree of corruption in Ethiopia's land administration. It has been estimated that a third of Ethiopians have paid a bribe to land administration officials engaged in forgery practices, thereby illegally assigning themselves some 15,000 titles, owing to corruption in the judiciary. There is a lack of confidence in the ability of the court system to resolve land disputes and challenge regulations. Liberalization of the telecom industry is at the forefront of Abiy's plan, announced in 2018, to privatize several sectors, including sugar, railways, and industrial parks. Abiy and his agents have since merchandised land and public institutions, such as Ethio Telecom, to the highest bidders, funds that now help finance the wars in Oromia and Tigray. Abiy and his officials have silently continued the EPRDF's Addis Ababa master plan by dispensing Oromo land and destroying Oromo culture around Addis Ababa, Finfini. These economic practices are a de facto continuation of Ethiopia's imperial system. The land, labor, and resources of marginalized people, particularly in central and southern regions, are used for a violent nation-building project that seeks to destroy their culture and political autonomy. State violence. Any Oromo who does not conform to the neo-Neftegna revisionist history, cultural destruction, economic exploitation, and land dispossession is liable to be subject to state violence. That violence has been used to impose fear on the public as a ploy to change their political behavior and make them support the current administration. The Ethiopian government has never refrained from attacking the OLF and OLA, along with the Oromo public, to destroy the Oromo struggle for self-determination. Starting in 2018, when Abiy came to power, members of OLA and the Kiru, Kari movement have been hunted and killed or detained in many places across Oromia. Extrajudicial killings by Ethiopia's security forces, rule or exception. By Ermias Tasfaye, soon after he came to power, Abiy established military command posts in some parts of Oromia, such as Wello, Welega, Guji, and central Oromia, giving them a free hand to kill Oromo youth and other civilians who were suspected to be Oromo nationalists or sympathizers of the OLF and the OLA. When asked why the government failed to destroy the OLA at a Prosperity Party meeting, Fekadu Tesema, a party official, said, "If you want to completely get rid of all the fish, you will need to dry up the ocean." Fekadu was declaring war on the Oromo public because they supported the OLA. Having declared war on Oromia and the OLA, the administration massacred or imprisoned mainly Oromo students and farmers in Wello, Walaga, Guji, central Oromia, and other areas. The Prosperity Party system also seems to have given at least tacit support for Amhara Fano militias attacking Oromo civilians. Regional forces from Amhara, Somali, and other regions, and reportedly Eritrean troops, are now engaged in brutality against the Oromo people. Ethiopia must address impunity for human rights abuses by security forces. By Eilmehu B. Hordofa, Amnesty International notes, Ethiopian security forces committed horrendous human rights violations, including burning homes to the ground, executions, rape, arbitrary arrests, and detentions, in response to attacks by armed groups and inter-communal violence in Amhara and Oromia. Public executions have also taken place. On the 11th of May 2021, for instance, government forces summarily executed Emmanuel Wandimu, a 17-year-old boy, in daylight at a square in Dambi Dolo. Emmanuel was accused of being a member of an assassin group named Abar Torbi, and was killed without due process. These actions are intended to terrorize Oromos so that they abandon their struggle for self-determination. But, the opposite is happening across Oromia as Oromo nationalism has further developed. More and more young people have joined the OLA, and many support the fight for survival and freedom, including many youths who were part of the Kiru, Kari movement. Oromia's future, the current Neo-Neftegna administration has left no room for the peaceful Oromo struggle that brought Abiy to power in 2018. Abiy and his supporters are now determined to destroy the OLF, OLA, and the spirit of Oromo nationalism. At this historical juncture, the Oromo people have one of two choices: either join the struggle to achieve sovereignty and democracy or continue to be persecuted by Abiy's Neo-Neftegna administration, which is trying to eliminate all Oromo descent by killing and detaining Oromo nationalists and their leaders. Ethiopia's multinational federalism ruins Isaias's assimilationist scheme, 19 April 2022 by Hagos Gabrimlak. Tigrayan nationalism is a barrier to the creation of an Eritrean identity. In an interview with the Eritrean state-owned television network on 8 January, President Isaias Afwerki critiqued the Ethiopian constitution by saying it was designed to institutionalize ethnic identity, and that the federal system it prescribed is the source of all problems in Ethiopia. These opinions are not new. In many of his interviews, Isaias has passionately reiterated that Ethiopia should engage in a centralized nation-building project and abandon ethnic federalism. However, he is not saying this out of concern for the welfare of Ethiopia. Rather, the reason for his obsession with this topic is that Eritrean nation-building is hampered by the presence of a Tigrayan identity that transcends the current state boundaries. Nation-building. All of the countries in the Horn of Africa were created during European colonialism in the 19th century and have cross-boundary ethnic groups. For instance, Oromos live in Ethiopia and Kenya, Afar in Ethiopia, Eritrea, and Djibouti, Somalis in Ethiopia, Djibouti, and Somalia, and Nuer in Ethiopia and South Sudan. Similarly, Tigrayan people live in Ethiopia's Tigray region as well as in Eritrea. In the late 19th century, Tigrinya speakers were divided and incorporated into the Italian colony of Eritrea and the Shuin-led Kingdom of Ethiopia. They are an overwhelming majority in Eritrea, mainly occupying the country's highland areas. Isaias has been trying to construct a singular, Eritrean national identity from the 9 ethnic groups in Eritrea. His nation-building project thus requires that the identity of the Tigrinya-speaking people of Eritrea be eliminated and that a new, Eritrean identity is cultivated. Ethnic federalism, a theory threatening to kill Ethiopia by Kasahan Meles. However, the Tigray nation is relatively homogeneous, with no clan structures and with deep social trust. The people on both sides of the border share the same language, religion, history, and territory. Even many of the current leaders of the ruling People's Front for Democracy and Justice (PFDJ) party, including Isaias, are either from Tigray or have parents from Tigray. Conversely, many top Tigray People's Liberation Front (TPLF) leaders, including the late Meles Zenawi, have parents from present-day Eritrea. It is thus almost impossible to separate the Tigray nation into Eritrean and Ethiopian camps. Accordingly, Isaias is of the opinion that his nation-building project can't easily be finalized without Ethiopia adopting the same approach. Assimilationist Isaias has long understood that without Tigray's complete assimilation into Ethiopia, Tigrayans in Eritrea would not give up their identity, and this would stymie the project of constructing a common Eritrean identity. Accordingly, for his project to be successful, the Ethiopian federal arrangement that protects and promotes group identities should be abolished and the assimilationist nation-building project needs to be revitalized. Once Tigray is sufficiently assimilated into Ethiopia, his hope is that the national consciousness of Tigrinya speakers in Eritrea will weaken, which will help in realizing his project. This demonstrates that the core reason for the rivalry between Isaias and the TPLF was the fact that the latter defended ethnic federalism. TPLF accommodation. TPLF's original objective was to establish Tigray as an independent nation-state. But these ambitions evolved over time. The Eritrean People's Liberation Front (EPLF) was by far the most powerful rebel group fighting the Derg regime. TPLF thus sought support from EPLF and compromised its original objective of securing Tigray's independence. According to Isaias, the alliance made TPLF shift its goals. TPLF half-heartedly changed its program from establishing a Republic of Tigray into staying in a federated Ethiopia. TPLF's ambiguous journey in Ethiopia by Berhanu Kabede. Isaias's expectation during the immediate post-Derg era was that TPLF would rule Ethiopia as a unitary state, or at least not as an ethnic federation. But, to his displeasure, the 1995 constitution not only adopted a multinational federal system but even gave the nations, nationalities, and peoples of Ethiopia a self-determination right that included a constitutional right to secede. In an interview, he said, "Not just Article 39, but the whole spirit of the Constitution is not one that you would crave for nation building. In my reading, it is not good for the people of Ethiopia or any other people." Eritrean meddling Isaias also thinks that Eritrea is justified in meddling in Ethiopia's affairs for national security reasons. In the same interview, he said, "We can't say Ethiopia's domestic affairs are their own. What we saw during the past 60 or 80 years over three generations is that our affairs are directly related to the situation in Ethiopia. We can live in peace, brotherhood, collaboration, and respect with Ethiopians. But, first, the stability of Ethiopia needs to be determined." He also revealed his disappointment with the Ethiopian government pulling out its armed forces from most of Tigray last June, while also implying that Eritrea could continue its military intervention in Ethiopia with greater intensity. Autonomy struggle. Although Isaias accuses TPLF of introducing a toxic and divisive system by institutionalizing multinationalism and self-determination, TPLF was partly dethroned in 2018 because it violated the constitution and installed a de facto centralized party-state system that undermined groups' self-determination rights. The main reason behind historic strife in Ethiopia has been the question of self-determination, as ethnic groups struggled to achieve self-governance and socio-economic justice. irreconcilable aspirations, a regressive Ethiopian vision spells the end of the Republic by Adisalem Desta. Since Ethiopia's formation as a modern state, there have been recurrent conflicts between two camps, those who have wanted to dominate and assimilate others, and those who have resisted that and struggled for independence. Nationality and self-determination questions have been at the heart of every war and rebellion since Ethiopia's expansion in the late 19th century. The social forces behind the movements that removed the imperial, military, and TPLF-led regimes centered on such questions. At the heart of the Kiru movement that helped bring down the EPRDF, for instance, were the historical and modern-day cultural suppression, economic exploitation, and political oppression of the Oromo that included the denial of genuine self-administration. Failed unity. A nation-building project via centralization has repeatedly failed in Ethiopia. The imperial-era centralization project failed when the Derg took power in 1974. The Derg continued the project through massive militarization and villagization programs. But this, too, had proven to be a failure by 1991. The EPRDF's policies of a centrally managed, highly monopolized economy that trumped regional states' autonomy proved to be a continuation of the same centralization project. Abiy's similar attempts have led to the current crisis and the failure of the much-anticipated democratization process. What Ethiopia now needs is a radical devolution where power is given to regional states and lower constituent units. Accordingly, nation building of the type President Isaias demands is practically impossible in Ethiopia. His prescriptions for Ethiopia are destructive, and, if implemented, the backlash could lead to the federation's complete disintegration. Exporting disaster, although its present-day borders were created by Italian colonialism, Eritrea was one of the oldest and most powerful civilizations in the world during the Aksumite Empire. It was the cradle of the Garay civilization and the Aksumite trading empire across the Red Sea, while Adulis was the trading hub for global merchants. Despite being an independent Italian colony, Eritrea was denied sovereignty by the United Nations after World War II. At the time, it was in the interest of the US and Allied powers that Eritrea was yoked in the name of federation with Ethiopia. The invasions and encroachments made Eritrea's history full of agony and resilience. Eritrea's Final War, by Kjetil Tronvoll. Finally, Eritrea secured independence in 1993 and restored its dignity. Even after going through a destructive war of independence from Ethiopia between 1961 and 1991, Eritrea had a solid potential for industrialization, in part due to the infrastructure built by the Italians. Yet, thanks to Isaias's authoritarianism and nation-building effort that he embarked on a few years after independence, Eritrea has been experiencing a post-independence stagnation. His brutal nation-building scheme has isolated the country from the international community and put its potential to waste. His disastrous policies have created an all-around socio-economic debacle. Furthermore, he imposed his totalitarian vision via the inhuman national service program. He underdeveloped Eritrea, seemingly intentionally, and is now trying to export his disastrous policy to Ethiopia. Sadly, some Ethiopian politicians want to do what Isaias has done and engage in a unitarist, assimilationist program. But Eritrea can't be a role model for diverse Ethiopia, as Eritrea is a de facto nation-state with an overwhelming majority of Tigrinya speakers. Isaias's brutal and repressive tactics such as forced conscription have led to an exodus of Eritrean youth, which then, paradoxically, created internal stability. This gives Isaias the upper hand over Eritrea's unstable neighbors. Unholy Trinity, there are three powers that strive to dominate the Ethiopian center and impose their preferred systems, Isaias, TPLF, and unitarist Ethiopian forces. This trinity poses a threat to the self-determination rights of the nations, nationalities, and peoples of Ethiopia. Therefore, a balance of power should be put in place to prevent the hegemonic ambitions of Isaias or any one of these three political forces. The force that can defeat Isaias's ambition is Tigrayan nationalism. Freedom fighter veterans who served during the armed struggle for independence under the EPLF are now forging such a movement. They are also mobilizing the youth in the diaspora. This movement is already delegitimizing Isaias in the diaspora. Even the internal political dynamics of Tigray are being shaped by the explosion of Tigrayan nationalism that is challenging any hegemonic ambition that TPLF might have. Abiy's government should distance itself from Isaias and mend its relations with the international community. It should also build consensus with federalist political elites within the country, mainly those in Oromia, as this would help in curbing the assimilationist ambitions of the unitarist camp. Abiy's botched centralization fuels Ethiopia's feuding centrifugal forces, 30 April 2022, by René Lefort, Ethiopia Insight. The only way forward for Ethiopia is allowing greater autonomy. The indefinite humanitarian truce, declared by the federal government on 24 March, was welcomed by Ethiopia's international partners, but led to highly divergent predictions. For some, it brought a glimpse of hope, a cautious optimism, and is a first step towards a complicated peace, indicating that the time for talks finally seems to be upon us. For others, Addis Ababa's covert goal is buying time to prepare for new military offensives. Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed wanted a humanitarian truce to camouflage his military plans. He just recently rearmed. He wants blood, claimed Rashid Abdi, a prominent analyst. Let's try to start with the facts. First of all, for 4 months, the Tigrayans have not gone on the offensive again to try and break the blockade. Two explanations, which are not mutually exclusive, spring to mind. One, they do not have the military strength to do so, and two, the Tigrayan leadership continues to hope that the secret talks with Addis Ababa will eventually succeed. According to credible diplomatic sources, these discussions expanded to involve Tigrayan and federal military commanders and then, despite denials by both sides, at least one extensive phone exchange between Abiy and Debretsion Gebremichael, Tigray's president. But only Addis Ababa and Mekelle were reportedly negotiating, without involving or even consulting, other Ethiopian parties, let alone Asmara. The parties set out the terms of a 30-day cessation of hostilities, the specifics of lifting the blockade, the continuation of negotiations to achieve a permanent ceasefire, and, beyond that, an attempt to address Ethiopia's fundamental political problems. It was agreed that it would be made public simultaneously in Addis Ababa and Mekelle, thus committing both to its terms. Suddenly, however, the Ethiopian government unilaterally announced on 24 March the indefinite humanitarian truce with the purpose to ensure the free flow of emergency humanitarian aid to all those in need of assistance. Once again, Abiy had reneged on his commitments. A truce is a time-limited suspension of fighting, often for humanitarian reasons. A ceasefire is more formal, commits both sides, and normally opens the path to peace talks. By declaring a truce, notably without specifying its geographical scope, the practicalities of its implementation, and any plans to advance the negotiations, Abiy distanced himself from the agreement with Mekelle and released himself from the obligations of a cessation of hostilities. Conflicting imperatives. Yulkal Kefal, president of Amhara, which is governed by Abiy's ruling party, reiterated bellicose statements against the TPLF last month. 2 days before the truce, he said that the goal was to conclude the war, and claimed the plan to finish it has been concluded and the ENDF is working on it. In late February, Gedu Andargakiu, former Amhara president and Abiy's national security advisor, said that because TPLF's threatening activity continued, the war is not over yet. According to the website TIGAT, Awal Aba, president of the Afar region and a staunch supporter of Abiy, stated strong opposition to aid getting into Tigray due in part to the TDF occupation of parts of Afar. Thus, it is likely that the Amhara and Afar leaders got wind of the Addis Ababa-Mekelle agreement, leading Abiy to change his plan. The Prime Minister is caught between competing interests. First, he faces Western pressures, particularly from the US, and the additional risks posed by Senior 3199 in the Senate and H.R. 6600 in the House of Representatives. Those bills threaten to cut off funds to Ethiopia, except for humanitarian purposes, and require the U.S. government to defend this position in international financial institutions. Oromo Nationalism in the Era of Prosperity Party by Negesse Diop. Emperor Haile Selassie's government expanded and consolidated the Neftegna Gubba system before changes occurred in the Ethiopian Empire State during subsequent administrations that came to power in 1974, 1991, and 2018. Although the 1974 revolution nationalized land and changed the status of the Gubba in the central and southern regions, the fundamental nature of the state was not changed. In fact, the new militarized socialist state intensified the brutalization of marginalized groups, including Oromos. The same is true about the change of government in 1991. Despite the TPLF-dominated EPRDF adopting multinational federalism, it largely existed only on paper. The EPRDF was never really committed to the self-determination rights that it gave lip service to. Tigrayan elites and their collaborators from other ethnic groups were dominant and, in line with the Neo-Neftegna predecessors, exploited marginalized groups. Rewriting history, critics characterize the current regime as Neo-Neftegna, because it tries to modernize the Ethiopian state by glorifying imperial leaders and the history of the empire while denigrating the history of marginalized communities. Habesha elites under successive regimes have denied the colonization of the Oromo and presented them as invaders of Ethiopia, referring to the so-called Oromo migrations of the 16th and 17th centuries. But, as demonstrated by Muhammad Hassan and Mikuria Bulcha, the way Oromos are portrayed as invader expansionists is false. For instance, according to these two scholars, the Talama Oromo lived around the Blue Nile long before Christian highlanders moved to these areas in the 13th century. Revealing Barara, the long-lost African medieval city by Samuel C. Walker, the Neo-Neftegna system defenders use portrayals of Oromos as expansionist invaders to justify the brutal expansion of the Ethiopian state. In his various historically void speeches, Abiy lectures the long marginalized peoples of Ethiopia to forget how the Ethiopian Empire State brutalized the Oromo, Sidama, Somali, Kimant, Agu, Walata, Gambela, Berta, Gumas, and others. When Abiy articulates the greatness of Ethiopia and its leaders, what comes to mind for many members of these groups is brutality, state terrorism, and human rights violations. Despite Abiy and the Ethiopianist camp that supports him trying to discredit the historical narrative of these victimized groups and legitimize the crimes of successive Ethiopian governments, the people will never forget their real history. Cultural destruction. Abiy's Neo-Neftegna administration has also started ideological warfare on Oromoma, Oromo history, culture, identity, and nationalism by glorifying Amhara nationalism disguised as Ethiopianism. As the new administration tries to revive the assimilationist nation-building project, one aspect of the strategy involves the systematic attack of Oromo political and cultural institutions. Despite Abiy's administration giving lip service to the importance of Gadar, Sikhi leaders, it is oppressing Gadar leaders who are the custodians of Oromo culture, institutions, and democracy. For instance, on 1 December 2021, federal and Oromia government forces attacked a Gadar religious ceremony in Karayu, East Shewa Zone. They beat and abducted the Abba Gadar, the traditional head of religious, social, legal, and economic affairs, other community leaders, and innocent young men. The bodies of 14 people, including the Abba Gadar, were found the next day, while 25 others were unaccounted for and are believed to be dead. The administration has also intimidated and discouraged the primary Oromo civic institution known as the Maha Talama Self-Help Association (MTA) from functioning in Addis Abeba, Finfini, and beyond. In August 2020, Diribi Demuse Boku, the president of the association, was beaten by government forces at his home in Barayu. The final lesson is that Abiy is not totally bound by the Amhara nationalists and their more or less autonomous armed groups. Rashid Abdi predicted that Abiy cannot deliver on truce, war has already been hijacked by ethnic militias. Yet even the Amhara elite had to grudgingly accept the compromise inherent in the truce. What did they get in return? Probably a freer hand over Western Tigray to satisfy their irredentist thirst. It is doubtful that it was only by chance that Getachew Gemba, Amhara's vice president, led a delegation of 600 people in early April from all over the region to visit Welkade Tegede Seti Humara Zone. He said, "We will work to legalize the territorial and identity issue of the area. It was the same day that the first aid convoy in 3.5 months reached Mekelle. One worthwhile hypothesis is that Amhara nationalists may also have received assurances of stronger engagement against OLA. Amhara elites are increasingly vocal in denouncing the rise of Oromo nationalism, of which they consider OLA the most threatening component. Regarding conflicts in the Oromo special zone in Amhara, one Amhara security official recently said, "We have to speak up and fight before we die." Contradictory information presently, the information coming out is so biased and contradictory that it has become nearly impossible to decipher the truth. For instance, there is no reliable information on the status of military forces ENDF, TDF, OLA, and SARON, such as size, weaponry, and morale. In what appeared to be a leaked audio, General Satkan Gebretensi, a member of TDF Central Command, said that Abiy's military capability is under severe crisis. According to him, Tigray's army is now stronger as the youth fighters who reached Debrecena during last year's march to the capital have become soldiers. On the other hand, Birinu Jula, ENDF's chief of staff, retorts that the Tigray forces suffered huge morale damage, it is so weakened that it had to hire a lot of mercenaries. This, of course, is classic wartime propaganda. When Satkan claims, in the audio, that there is communication on a daily basis between him, Tadis Warede, TDF's top commander, and Birinu, the ENDF supremo denied it and played on the word meet by declaring that I didn't meet with a person called Satkan. Debrecen addressed a pressing appeal to UN Secretary-General Antonio Guterres to end the siege and warned that, if peaceful options are no longer viable, we will be forced to resort to other means to break the devastating blockade. Satkan, on the other hand, said, "We don't expect anything from others, international partners." He further said that Addis is so weakened militarily, economically, and diplomatically that it would have no choice but to negotiate. Fresh settlement. We must try to look beneath this froth at deeper currents. Over the longer term, the question is whether this truce marks the first step towards at least an incremental pacification of Ethiopia. This would mean assessing the impact on the country's fundamental problems and the heart of the crisis, namely, constructing a new way of living together between the country's 80 or so nations, nationalities, and peoples. The bigger picture behind this truce is increasingly bleak. Fragmentation is the major dynamic in Ethiopia today. That has led to, among others, the proliferation of local baronies with more or less autonomous control over fairly extensive territories. Regional state and non-state armed groups are militarizing to assert themselves. According to credible sources, the total of all regional forces plus Fano and equivalents is now double the size of the ENDF, without even counting the Kabele militias. These centrifugal forces are inseparable from the rise of increasingly fanatical identity-based sentiments, at least among the main nations of Ethiopia. They include a general feeling by multiple communities of being besieged and the victim of genocide. The record shows there is genocide in Tigray by Guillaume Emmett's highly symptomatic and symbolic that one of the strongest unifying links in Ethiopian society, the religions, particularly the Orthodox and Catholic churches, has been tested due to ethnic rifts. More recently, there has also been sectarian violence against Muslims in Gondar. These feelings are inseparable from an increasingly pronounced irredentism. Almost all kilils have territorial claims on other kilils that border them. All this leads to a growing conflict in this centrifugal process, marked by the intensification and multiplication of deadly clashes, where armed forces of all kinds confront each other in an increasingly barbaric manner. The Armed Conflict Location and Event Data Project assessed that conflict events increased by 161% in 2021. The federal government and almost all regional states have long since lost their monopoly on violence. As this indicates, we are dangerously close to a confrontation of all against all. Ethnic federalism, a theory threatening to kill Ethiopia by Kasahan Meles, according to Ezekiel Gebisa, an Oromo academic and activist, the main danger for Ethiopia is no longer Balkanization, but what he calls Rwandization. Last but not least, Ethiopia has de facto lost large parts of its sovereignty. With the weakening of the Ethiopian National Defense Force (ENDF), the Eritrean army is one of the strongest in the Horn, and it occupies parts of Tigray. Asmara is rumored to have gained a strong position in Ethiopia's security services. Meanwhile, it is bypassing Addis Ababa to forge increasingly close political and military links with parts of the Amhara elite. Eritrea's long-held strategy towards Ethiopia remains unchanged, to destroy the TPLF and make Tigray its hinterland, while at the same time weakening Ethiopia, whatever the cost, to the point where Isaias can play the puppet master, pulling the strings behind the scenes. Centrifugal forces. This violent scattering is too far-reaching to expect that what remains of the central power could find the strength to put the country back together. Whether we like it or not, the events of the last few years have answered the key conundrum: where can a possible answer to the existential question at the heart of the crisis in Ethiopia be found? It now appears that Ethiopia can only reach some order in a very loose ethnic federation. Fighting this reality would only intensify the centrifugal dynamics to the point of Balkanization. Tigray is a showcase in this regard. Getachew Reda, who was previously a strong supporter of keeping the region in the federation, had to admit that the main popular demand among the Tigrayan public now is independence or statehood, particularly among what he calls the resistance. It is often said that the so-called Amhara hegemonists or expansionists would be united in their opposition to such a loose federation. But this is only partly true.
Amhara nationalism at the polls in Ethiopia by Mystere So. First, the gap is growing between the most radical Gondar zone and the more moderate Goijam, Shewa, and Wello zones. Second, one must also consider the meteoric rise of Amhara nationalism, the refocusing of the Amhara pan-Ethiopian vision on Amharawinet, and its gradual impact. Informants in Amhara Shewa, when recently asked about what people around them were thinking, reported more or less the following: "We thought and acted more like Ethiopian citizens than Amhara. Because of this, we have not been able to come together and organize ourselves, be strong as Amhara, and resist the invasion of the Woyane. Our priority now must be to build a strong Amhara nation." They added, "Let the Tigrayans do what they want to do at home. Trying to go as far as Mekelle is absurd. All we want is to take back our territories that they are occupying. Salane Chain, former president of the National Movement of Amhara, an Amhara nationalist party, was asked, if you had to choose, who would you stand for, Ethiopia or Amhara? His answer was convoluted. Amhara can serve as a center and can advocate for the rights of other nationalities while fighting for its own rights as well. This is a far cry from the original goal of de-ethnicizing the federal system. Finally, the fact that Gonder mainly seeks and finds more support in Asmara than in Addis Abeba says a lot about the identity-based withdrawal of parts of the Amhara elite and therefore the strength of the trend towards seeking more autonomy. Abiy has always fought that trend, probably not for any ideological reason, however, but due to opportunism. This trend is the main obstacle to his personal ambition of becoming a true nationwide ruler. His personal position weakens with each passing day, so he maneuvers on a day-to-day basis to try to survive, but with no consistent direction. His struggle, paradoxically, accelerates the autonomous trend. The foreseeable failure of the farcical so-called national dialogue and the mass offensive against Ola confirm once more Abiy's military adventurism. For him, there is a military solution to political problems, despite the disasters that his military adventures led to, said Ezekiel Oromo. First, if we assess Abiy's record and compare the state of the country today to what it was in April 2018, there is no area of sustained positive development. His prosperity party is undermined by divisions, within or between its regional branches. The PP's General Assembly had already demonstrated these fractures. Unable to map a way out of the crisis, it could only agree on formulations that could be read as everything and its opposite. Nation building must be based on a strong foundation of Ethiopia win it on multinational fraternity, or national unity based on multinational federalism. The Oromara alliance is well and truly dead, as evidenced again by the recent surge of fighting on the Amhara-Oromia border, mainly in the Oromia zone of the Amhara region and West Welega. The war of words between the two sides is also raging. Oromia Broadcasting Network, Oromia Region's media, interviewed a West Welega official who said, Amhara extremists have taken Oromo land by force, to settle on it, and cultivate it. When a Fano chief said that the main war is yet to start, he must have this confrontation in mind.
A reconcilable aspirations, a regressive Ethiopian vision spells the end of the republic by Adeselam Desta. Finally, there is general disenchantment. Probably the majority of the population no longer supports the war with TPLF. Even the main wing in the diaspora, the conservatives, who idolized Abiy, turned their back on him, mainly after they were shocked by the release of Sebat Nega, a TPLF co-founder. Some even believe that the war in the north has been launched to weaken the Amhara and bring the Oromo closer to hegemony. If Abiy is still in power, it is mainly thanks to the weakness of his opponents. They are too divided to achieve the weight that their numbers should give them. With no signs that a credible roadmap or a strong opposition leadership will emerge, it is hard to see how Ethiopia can recover. In the interim, as long as these opponents consider Abiy useful during this reshaping, they will not really threaten his position. It appears that only the Oromos can be the driving force behind Ethiopia's recovery, because of their numbers and Oromia's relatively valuable natural endowment. They are also, above all, the main proponents of the ethnic federalist vision. What appears to be a must is a two-stage construction of a common front that would implement this ethnic federalist project. First, between the Oromo Liberation Front (OLF), Oromo Federalist Congress (OFC), and OLA. then, this intra-Oromo coalition would need to form a strong alliance with like-minded ethno-nationalist forces from other regions. However, this is a responsibility that the Oromo have historically never managed to assume, and that Abiy will do everything in his power to prevent. The Politics and Problems of Prosperity Party Gospel, the 4th of April 2021 by Mulabran Balarain, The Evangelical, Anti-Intellectual Politics Behind Abiy Ahmed's Prosperity Party is an under-examined force driving mass delusion, national decline, and war. In the last three decades, Ethiopia saw stability and steady economic growth. It also established itself as a linchpin of peace in the Horn of Africa and a strategic ally for the West. However, human rights violations, corruption, and a tight grip on power brought about popular protests between 2015 and 2018, culminating in Abiy Ahmed Ali becoming the new prime minister. Early on, Abiy was praised for his promises of democratic and liberal reforms. Indeed, he was so extolled internationally that he received the Nobel Peace Prize in 2019 for his efforts in a peace agreement, what others call a war deal, he made with Eritrea's President Isaias Afwerki. For as excellent a head start as Abiy had, his rapid diplomatic decline has been a shocking disappointment to external observers and Ethiopians alike. In just 3 years, he has become a diplomatic pariah, and his reign has been a bloody one even by the standards of our modern history, marred by multifaceted political and economic challenges that now threaten the very integrity of the Ethiopian Federation. Since 2018, he has around 5 million internally displaced people, 2.2 million in Tigray and 2.9 million elsewhere, multiple high-profile political assassinations, ethnic cleansing in western Tigray, more than 75,000 displaced peoples, at least 63,000 Tigrayans and 7,000 other Ethiopians in Sudan, two foreign countries, Eritrea and Sudan, occupying Ethiopian land, and 23.5 million Ethiopians estimated to be in need of urgent humanitarian support. There are various causes of Abiy's failures. However, there is one unique underlying condition characterizing Abiy's politics which few have processed fully, the Politics of Prosperity Party Gospel, PPG. As I shall argue, PPG, with its anti-pseudo-intellectual bent, is the most important driver behind Ethiopia's inauspicious descent into war and chaos under Abiy. The problem with Abiy's obsession with the PPG is not only that it was made a doctrine of a constitutionally non-sectarian government, but is also increasingly influencing policy decisions and government action. Elusive Politics, the Prosperity Gospel, is a version of Protestant Christianity that originated in the US, but is now very popular in Africa. In its simplest form, the doctrine of prosperity prescribes that if followers strongly feel and visualize what they want, then they can get it. It demands from its followers unquestioning faith and submission, and usually tithings given to the church and its leaders in return for a promise of guaranteed personal wealth and success. Abiy's leadership style is embedded in the ethos of these prosperity gospel philosophies. The Prosperity Party leaders want to persuade Ethiopians that things are going to be great, regardless of the grim realities they experience every day. In practice, this has meant that instead of addressing real problems, members of the Prosperity Party and the public have been encouraged to window dress symptoms of chronic problems. amidst the urgent political and humanitarian crises that have characterized his 3 years in power, Abiy has frequently been seen wasting time and political clout on extended visits and inaugurations of low-grade, low-impact projects such as parks, orchards, and palace renovations. He focuses on creating an artificial image of prosperity through carefully staged photoshoots that depict him amidst beautiful landscapes, exaggerated industrial achievements, and other such scenes. These carefully crafted visuals are meant to help the population focus on what is good, regardless of the reality that is veiled behind them, a typical prosperity gospel technique of positive imaging. Usually, what Abiy proudly advertises as his most important achievements have no bearing on real and urgent problems. As an example, many Ethiopians were dumbfounded when he went on national television to give viewers an hour-long personal tour into his palace renovation project, where he clearly insinuated that it was a great achievement that Ethiopians should be proud of. Lacking any economic and policy justification for such projects, he tried to explain them as ways of creating a good first impression for visitors. He claimed that if others saw the impressive facade of the palace, then they would believe that Ethiopia is a competent country and would give us more aid. Trying to justify his logic, he proclaimed that a beggar with a shiny suit will get more alms than one with shabby clothes. The only reason for Abiy to pursue such vanity projects with so much energy seems the prosperity gospel's prescription of surrounding oneself with good things in order to attract more of them. Here, we see a clear expression of PPG philosophies, the idea that shallow shows of beauty and positivity will manifest good results, even in spite of the reality behind the show. Mass delusion, the danger of such vanity projects is not only their abject disregard for the situation on the ground, but that the mass delusion takes hold of the party cadres and followers. People start to believe blindly in ideas that are incongruous to reality, they swell with nationalist pride and fall for false promises of quick economic development. This is an effect of PPG that has been documented in other African countries as well. For instance, the early months of 2021, when the world at large was shocked by the bloody war in Tigray, Abiy aired his prediction that Ethiopia will be one of two great superpowers in the world by 2050. Then, the Rising Ethiopia campaign was launched trying to deflect the world's attention from the horrors of war to an allegedly glorious and prospering Ethiopia. The collective delusion of Rising Ethiopia is so great that celebrities, religious leaders, and members of the public have joined the cult. And many are insisting that diplomatic pressures put on Ethiopia by the West, and the US in particular, are not a result of atrocity crimes being committed in Tigray, but, instead, the West trying to thwart Ethiopia's imagined ascent towards superpower status. Abiy's speeches and projects are more often characterized by prophetic tones and an unreasonably excessive optimism that is devoid of understanding of real events on the ground. It is as if Abiy is talking about another country, not Ethiopia. Indeed, he once claimed that Ethiopians are better off than most Western people because, unlike Europeans who often obtain things through credit, Ethiopians mostly pay for what they want up front. Abiy's affinity for prophecies and divine interventionism as inspiration for political decision-making is tolerated by more critical politicians and widely welcomed by many in the mass populace, whose political histories have been shaped through the influences of prophecies and prophets. Mind over matter, Abiy Ahmed's aim to Pentecostalize Ethiopian politics, by René Lafort, during introductory pleasantries at an IGAD meeting with East African heads of state. Abiy was heard professing that rain follows me wherever I go. Social media commentators have aptly interpreted this as Abiy trying to create parallelism with the prophetic arrival of Emperor Haile Selassie in Jamaica on 21 April 1996, which some Ethiopians wrongly understand to have caused rain to fall. Actually, rain stopped on the arrival of the monarch. His efforts to associate himself with Ethiopia's past emperors by glorifying those with notorious and controversial reputations, for example, by erecting life-size wax statuses, has been part of his way to create a kingly image of himself. Infamously, he revealed that his mother prophesied about him being the king of Ethiopia one day. Nowadays, religious leaders from across the spectrum can be seen running rampant across social media and state television endorsing Abiy and his war. Indeed, some have associated him with the prophet Moses, suggesting that Abiy will lead Ethiopians on the path towards greatness. Abiy presides over such approbations, grinning gleefully and nodding in agreement. He seems to truly believe in his own God-sent status, or at least seems to want people to think he does, and acts as if he is working to implement God's plan for Ethiopia. This belief, unfortunately, has been so inculcated that it was even publicly shared by his predecessor, Hailemariam Desalegn. At times, Ethiopian elites went as far as suggesting, on national television, that Abiy was a perfect leader, only that there are no people who deserve to be led by him. Abiy agrees, "My people don't understand me," he complained to diplomats. In another instance, Ethiopian state television found it acceptable to broadcast an individual claiming that Abiy will win the war on Tigray because Sheikh Jibril's prophecies are on his side. This is what Pastor Yonatan, a close friend of Abiy, said in one of his sermons. "I am saying this about the Prime Minister. The Lord says those who surround you, be them the Egyptians, the Sudanese, the Kenyans, Somalians, internal and external enemies, the diasporas, the Lord is saying, I am the one who put you on the throne, and I will keep you there, have no fear." Unholy Alliance, like other populist leaders, Abiy has managed to catch hold of emotions and desires for greatness in order to convince others, especially those who are susceptible to propaganda, to stamp out opposition alongside him. Dangerously, he has also managed to tap into the extreme right ethio-nationalist sentiment, offering visions of a return to a supposed more glorious past. These visions have found a stronghold among Amhara nationalists in particular, and fueled an appetite for war in order to achieve their ends at any cost. It's a vision of a strong and centralized Ethiopia, with a uniform culture and political system, rather than one which respects and protects the principles of cultural, linguistic, and political pluralism. For instance, Deacon Daniel Kibre, a person who is believed to be the ideologue behind the quasi-political religious association of Mahabir Kijusan, or the Association of the Saints, has effectively utilized the PPG's affinity for prophetic rhetoric as an opportunity to propagate right-wing Ethiopian nationalist narrations. He has used his personal talent in parabolic writing to influence Abiy's speeches and writings. It was, therefore, not altogether surprising that Deacon Daniel claimed Ethiopia was at its best when the war on Tigray was raging and thousands of civilians were being massacred by Eritrean mercenaries and Amhara militia during a total communication blackout. Though it shocks many of us to hear that Ethiopia could be at its best while in the midst of a brutal civil war, Daniel was genuine in his claim. This is because, for him and the unitarist political camp, the best is when the political influence and presence of other nations and nationalities, especially the Tigrayan peoples, are minimized or removed completely. War in Tigray, Ethiopia's Nobel Peace, surprise by Isaias Ergao. War, with all of its destruction and suffering, becomes a necessary fate in order to accomplish such ruthless aims. Of course, it also helps that Abiy has made the promise to Amhara right-wing elites to grant territorial claims, an irresistible reward for the price of violence. This idea that Ethiopia shall prevail no matter the cost, so far, has meant conflicts in Tigray, Oromia, Benishangul Gumuz, the consequent civilian massacres, weaponized rape, intentional starvation, and ethnic cleansing. Since PPG literally guarantees victory, it has made Prosperity Party officers frighteningly confident about anything they do and speak. Abiy felt so confident that he made his now infamous claim of victory without any civilian causality in his law and order operation in Tigray. Excessive confidence about such grave matters as civilian casualties can only mean that either Abiy thought he could successfully hide the killings in Tigray or that he genuinely believes that extra-earthly powers are manifesting what he wants to be true. Only Abiy knows which, but given his insistence in continuing with his campaign in Tigray, even at the risk of his own diplomatic decline, it seems that he is still confident of not only victory, which does not seem to be guaranteed anymore, even according to the assessment of his own generals, but also that everything will be okay afterward. Typical PPG optimism, oblivious to the grim reality at hand. Here, we see an unholy merger between religious delusion and nationalist populism, which engenders an endless appetite for violence. As is common with populist movements everywhere, Abiy has successfully appealed to the desires of the masses, and instead of doing the hard work of governance, he has inspired people towards continuous war with what seem to be ever more distant promises of peace and prosperity. Spreading pseudo-science PPG ideologies normalize pseudo-intellectualism and, in extreme cases, anti-intellectualism in Ethiopia. It is perhaps expected that when divine intervention and prophecies are the official explanations for political events and change, scientific analysis would be sidelined and even shunned. Abiy goes to great lengths to create an intellectual image of himself. For example, he stages photo shoots where he appears to be seriously immersed while reading a book. There are records where he appeared in public clearly plagiarizing others. His two books published in a rush before he became prime minister were severely criticized for lacking content and being nothing more than sophistry, a hodgepodge of ideas constructed with rhetorical fallacies and delivered with pseudo-intellectual, evangelical self-help fervor. Alex Duval, comparing Abiy's book Medema with the approach followed by the Tigray People's Liberation Front (TPLF) leadership, wrote, "One of the attractions of Abiy's philosophy of Medema, synergy or coming together, is precisely that it lacks the intellectual rigor characteristic of the TPLF leadership and their fellow revolutionaries. Medema needs a skilled politician able to conduct negotiations simultaneously on different levels and according to different political logics to realize its potential. Unfortunately, Abiy hasn't exhibited those skills. His trademark has been a combination of naivete, impatience, and overconfidence. Moreover, in the hands of some of Abiy's disciples, Medema has become a tool of excommunicating dissenters from the political community. Intellectual rigor aside, it should be remembered that Abiy also used questionable ways of promoting his book. Apparently, public funds were spent to prepare lavish book launch events throughout the country and abroad, and the events focused on encouraging a personality cult rather than creating an opportunity to discuss the book's substance. Abiy himself made lots of outrageous pseudoscientific claims, such as the humorous one that blessing water turns it into healing water, that the human body is composed of water, air, and fire, and that cancer is caused by bad words one utters. He once claimed that Haramaya Lake in southeastern Ethiopia, which dried more than a decade ago, returned because of the seedlings that he helped plant just a year before. In probably one of the most daring displays of pseudo-intellectualism, Ethiopia's Higher Education and Innovation Minister, Abraham Bile, announced, on national television, that the Ethiopian Ministry of Science and Technology has discovered a cure for COVID-19, before the first case was confirmed in Ethiopia. This announcement by a member of his cabinet, I think, would not have happened without Abiy's request or, at least, approval. Suppressing dissent, since Abiy seems to have faith that his ideas and whims are divinely guided, he seems to see those who oppose or criticize him as opposing not just him, but his God. In fact, symbolisms of likening critics and opposition with the biblical Satan have been normalized. The opposition is viewed as a hurdle to surmount or a form of ignorance that must be defeated in order for his visions to come to full fruition. Abiy is, therefore, disposed to remove such hurdles. Many of the high-profile assassinations, extrajudicial killings, and mass detentions have not been properly investigated, and commentators rightly suspect that the government may have a hand in these. When Abiy asked the TPLF to join his prosperity party and they rejected the offer, citing ideological differences and the need for discussion and clarity before any kind of merger, he did not try to convince them using any justifications as to why the party would be beneficial to them. Instead, according to Getachew Reader, he said, "Just join me and everything shall be great." It was as if he was saying, I have a vision and I don't know how it will materialize, just go along with me and trust that it will somehow be okay in the end. Abiy's pseudo-intellectual tendencies have predictably put him at odds with seasoned and experienced experts on various critical matters concerning Ethiopia's politics and its future. Often, experts are left with no option but to call him out for his silly mistakes as well as his more serious transgressions. Therefore, through time, he and his party colleagues have developed a profound distaste for experts. Some who have tried to criticize his ways and policies based on sound evidence and reasoning have been personally attacked and threatened by Abiy's supporters and social media propagandists. Professors and political analysts have reported being condemned and even blackmailed on television for their opinions, for instance on the war in Tigray. Many experts and analysts who have been voicing their concerns about the war in Tigray and its possible grave consequences to Ethiopia have been accused of being TPLF paid lobbyists. It strikes me that almost all of the people accused of being TPLF's paid agents by Abiy's government and supporters are those who have built the careers and professional reputations through years of actual work, research, and engagement in Ethiopia. Ethiopia's treacherous transition by Goitom Tekle, Abiy's government goes so far as to expel experts for reporting undesirable information that does not confirm the reality he wants to present to the world. For others, government-affiliated online social media accounts have led smear campaigns to tarnish their reputation with ugly, false accusations. Personal communication with a few others revealed that they have been declared persona non grata, just because of the critical views against Abiy's government and its policies. Worse, when such experts and activists are Ethiopians, arrest warrants on accusations of national treason are issued against them, including, ironically, an academic, Awol Kassim Allo, who nominated Abiy for the Nobel Peace Prize. On the other hand, Abiy's Prosperity Party gives disproportionate privilege and airtime to experts of dubious and questionable expertise. A gay erotica writer turned historian Jeff Pierce is one of such experts whose writings, that at times clearly run against factual evidence, are covered by government websites. T-Tube. Today, 2 May 2022. Exceptional program. Headlines. Ethiopian Prime Minister turned down offer from EAC country to send fighters to help against rebels, source claims, Sudan's Post May 1, 2022. Under international pressure, the federal government promised a truce in Tigray but is now losing ground to the Oromo insurgency. An Oromo rebellion constrains Abiy. 28 April 2022, Sudan's Post May 1, 2022. Ethiopia's Tigray rebels claim withdrawal from afar, but Abiy's government denies. Ethiopian Prime Minister Dr. Abiy Ahmed had reportedly turned down an offer from an East African country in 2021 to send fighters to help in the fight against then-advancing Tigray People's Liberation Front (TPLF) rebels. A senior security official who is aware of the offer said, Addis Ababa, Ethiopian Prime Minister Dr. Abiy Ahmed had reportedly turned down an offer from an East African country in 2021 to send fighters to help in the fight against then-advancing Tigray People's Liberation Front (TPLF) rebels. A senior security official who is aware of the offer said, fighting occurred in the northern region of Tigray after armed elements belonging to the TPLF attempted to disarm Federal Army's Northern Command. The government in Addis Ababa then sent in troops in a campaign dubbed as Law Enforcement Operation, capturing Tigray capital Mekelle in days. But in a matter of a few months, Tigray rebels advanced following an abrupt withdrawal from Federal Army forces and their Amhara and Afar regional allies, threatening to capture the capital Addis Ababa, sparking fears among diplomatic missions for fall of Addis Ababa. Speaking to Sudan's Post this afternoon, a security source that refused not to be identified said one of the East African countries then offered to send in troops to Ethiopia to fight alongside the federal forces, but then Prime Minister Ahmed turned down that offer. You know us in Ethiopia, and as Ethiopians we depend on ourselves. The news that there are foreign fighters in this country is just propaganda to derail the peaceful end to this conflict, because the federal government and the federal army is for peaceful end to the conflict, the security source said. Let me tell you, in August last year, Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed got an offer from an East African country to send troops to Ethiopia to help when the rebels captured some areas in Afar and Amhara region. This is because that country that I do not want to name was concerned about Ethiopian fate of these terrorist entered Addis Ababa. The PM refused that offer and he went to the frontline himself and beat them. So, there are no foreign fighters fighting alongside our forces against the TPLF, he added. Share this, under international pressure, the federal government promised a truce in Tigray but is now losing ground to the Oromo insurgency just weeks after its 24 March announcement of an indefinite humanitarian truce, in the civil war in northern Ethiopia centered around the defiant Tigray region. The federal government declared another offensive against the Oromo Liberation Army OLA, in a Oromia, the largest of Ethiopia's 11 semi-autonomous regional states.
Ethiopia's Tigray government claim withdrawal from Afar, but Abiy's government denies Ethiopia's rebellious Tigray People's Liberation Front TPLF, has said that it no longer has presence in the regional state of Afar, months after international uproar over its presence, which aid organizations said contributed to blockage of aid entry into the war-ravaged Tigray region. Addis Ababa, Ethiopia's rebellious Tigray People's Liberation Front TPLF, has said that it no longer has presence in the regional state of Afar, months after international uproar over its presence, which aid organizations said contributed to blockage of aid entry into the war-ravaged Tigray region. Conflict broke out in November 2020 between the central government in Addis Ababa and the TPLF, then ruling party in the Tigray region. This followed attacks by gunmen belonging to the TPLF on several federal army government positions in the northernmost region. The government launched a law enforcement operation evicting the rebel group from the capital Mekelle. However, in a matter of a few months, rebels advanced southward following government withdrawal from Mekelle, threatening to capture the capital Addis Ababa, but were then repulsed following waves of several battles that saw Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed attending to front lines. Late last year, the rebel group said it had withdrawn from all regions outside Tigray, but then sent in troops to some parts of Amhara and Afar, claiming that the intention was to block continued federal army attacks on Tigray areas bordering the two regions. The international community and the government in Addis Ababa have voiced concerns over the presence of Tigray forces in Afar and have constantly urged the rebel group to withdraw its forces to areas of Tigray to enable aid entry amid claims of aid blockage. Last month, the TPLF said it was committed to further withdrawal from Afar, and now the TPLF spokesman Getachew K. Raider says that they have no presence in the Afar region and did not mention as to when precisely the pullout from Afar was conducted. A note to the international community and to all concerned: for the record, there are no Tigray forces, literally none, left in Afar. The authorities in Addis Ababa know this. And you know it too, more or less. Needless to say, the blockade still continues. Getachew said, big lies, but the government in Addis Ababa said the reports of rebel withdrawal from Afar region are untrue, with Leges Tulu, a government spokesman, telling state media that the media reports of a rebel pullout were big lies. Afar police said Tigrayan forces are in Koneba, Abala, Berhale and Megale with no changes since Monday, Reuters reported. T-Tube argues Abiy is a liar, he is sweeping the people of Tigray. And the terminology calling TDF rebel group is inappropriate and unethical. The international medias have to call TDF by its name.